Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship here on this very nice, cool, drizzly day. We're really glad for the rain, for all of that'll bring to us, and we're glad that you have joined us. Whether you're a member or a guest, we're extremely glad that you're here, and we know that wherever you are in your faith journey, Jesus indeed meets you here. Start off our worship service with a few announcements. Tonight at 4 o'clock, there is pumpkin bingo. You can come and you can play bingo and win pumpkins. It should be a really fun time. I wish I could join, but it'll be a lot of fun, and obviously get some pumpkins. You can make pies or carve them or whatever you want to do with that. So if you want to join that, that's from 4 to 5:30 tonight. And then shortly after that, at 7 o'clock tonight, is the National Youth Gathering Information Meeting. If you if you're a kid, a young adult in grades 8 through 12 currently, you are welcome to go to the National Youth Gathering, and you're encouraged to do so. But we need numbers by next week. So if you have any interest at all, there's a meeting tonight for youth and for a parent. You'll get a lot of information. It's in Minneapolis this year, so you don't have to go that far. And honestly, I went as a youth, and it was one of my favorite experiences that I've ever done. So if you have any interest in going to the National Youth Gathering, please be here at 7 o'clock tonight to allow planners to get numbers and other information. You may have noticed the tin bucket in the back there. We're kind of doing noisy offering again, but still in place. So that money will go towards the mission team, the Christmas stuff. I'm not really sure what it goes to. Anybody know? Mission Christmas. Okay, so that money will go towards Mission Christmas, and they need your donations because the more that they have in their fund, the more people they can help, and the better they can make this community. So remember to bring your change or loose dollar bills or whatever, and drop them in there either as you're entering or exiting the worship service. Let's see. There's a lot of announcements, so I invite you to read all of them as you have time. But are there any other announcements for the good of the congregation? I know there's one. Val here.
Good morning. It's Pastor Appreciation Sunday. Pastor Kyle, we are so grateful that God brought us together during this time of transition in our congregation, and we thank you for sharing your talents with us. We appreciate you. So now, congregation, I invite you to join me in saying thank you on the count of three. One, two, three. Thank you.
Thank you all. Now I invite you to please stand as you're able as we go into confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God whose teaching is life, whose presence is sure, and whose love is endless. Let us confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our comforter, like lost sheep, we have gone astray. We gaze upon abundance and see scarcity. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth with our apathy and greed. Free us from our sin, gracious God. Listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. We will continue here with our gathering song, Here I Am, Lord. Number four. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Yeah.
in the world, for the health of the church, for the unity of all. For this holy house, for all who worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Let us pray to the Lord. Kyrie eleison, on our world and on our way. Kyrie eleison, every day.
That we may live out your impassioned response to the hungry and the poor. That we may live out truth and justice and grace, let us pray to the Lord.
Let us pray to the Lord. Kyrie eleison, on our world and on our way. Kyrie eleison, every day.
For peace in our hearts, for peace in our homes, for friends and family. For life and for love, for our work and our play, let us pray to the Lord.
Let us pray to the Lord. Kyrie eleison, on our world and on our way. Kyrie eleison, every day.
For your spirit to
eleison, on our world and on our way.
Let us pray together the prayer of the day. Almighty and ever-living God, increase in us your gift of faith, that forsaking what lies behind and reaching out to what lies ahead, we may follow the way of your commandments and receive the crown of everlasting joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. A reading from Amos. Seek the Lord and live, or he will break out against the house of Joseph like fire, and it will devour Bethel, with no one to quench it. Ah, you that turn justice to wormwood and bring righteousness to the ground. They hate the one who reproves in the gate, and they abhor the one who speaks the truth. Therefore, because you trample on the poor, and take from them levies of grain. You have built houses of hewn stone, but you shall not live in them. You have planted pleasant vineyards, but you shall not drink their wine. For I know how many are your transgressions, and how great are your sins. You who afflict the righteous, who take a bribe, and push aside the needy in the gate. Therefore, the prudent shall keep silent in such a time, for it is an evil time. Seek good and not evil, that you may live, and so the Lord, the God of hosts, will be with you. Just as you have said, hate evil and love good, and establish justice in the gate, that it may be the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. The word of the Lord. The responsive reading today is from Psalm 90. So teach us to number our days. Return, O Lord, how long will you tarry?
Be gracious to your servants.
Satisfy us by your steadfast love in the morning.
So shall we.
Make us glad as many days as you afflicted us. Show your servants your works.
And your splendor.
May the graciousness of the Lord our God be upon us. A reading from Hebrews. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joins from marrow, it is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him, no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who is in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. The word of the Lord.
Please stand as you are able. The Holy Gospel, according to Mark, the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked, and he went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers, or sisters, or mother, or father, or children, or fields, for my sake and for the sake of good news, who will not receive 100-fold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children, and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated, and I invite the children to come up for a children's message. Good morning. How are you guys all today?
Good.
So last week we talked about how you guys are supposed to teach the adults, right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So what good things do you guys do? What do you do that's good? Do you like help your parents? Do you help your siblings? Do you do things like that?
Yes.
Yeah? And do you do them without expecting to, like, get candy or things like that?
No.
No? You still want to get candy, right?
I get money.
Your grandma gives you candy? Okay. Well, when you do good things, do you think you're always going to get candy?
No.
Do you only do good things to get candy?
Yeah.
That's the only reason you do good things?
Yeah.
Well, what we should be doing...
Grammy gives me candy.
She gives you candy? Maybe they shouldn't give you guys candy.
Daddy,
well, the reason we should be doing good things is not to get candy. Okay? If you did a nice thing and your parents didn't give you candy, would you do that nice thing again?
No.
You should, right? Yeah. That's what you should do. But do you know why? You do? The reason that we should do good things and not get candy from it is because we're doing them because we love God. And we love our parents, and we love everybody else.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Or love our grandma and grandpa, or whoever.
Yeah.
We do good things to show them that we love them. And that's what Jesus tells us to do today. He doesn't say, do good things for your own sake. He says, do it because we love God. Do it for God, and do it for other people. So that's why we do good things. Okay? So, let's pray. Dear God, thank you for our time together, and thank you for all these kids. We pray together here, and we ask that you help us to learn, that you help us to grow, and you help us to be good, to show everybody your love. We also ask that you do give us candy on occasion. In your name we pray. And all God's children said, amen. All right. So, I'll give you guys candy, but the other thing that I forgot to say and then I remembered while I was praying is that even though you get candy here for doing good things, if we do good things and love God, you get so much more candy later. Okay? So you guys can have one. One piece of candy. And then I thank you guys for coming up. And actually, if you want to grab a coloring sheet over there too, you guys can do that. I'll give you a second prize. Nope, no blue. These are the regular Starburst.
I'm gonna give one to my mommy.
I want to, Grandma. I like Starburst.
Okay. Once you guys have candy, go back to your seat, okay?
Okay, Grandma.
And then get one too, quick, Grandma.
Okay. So all you little ones, I noticed that a lot of you took multiple pieces of candy. I hope that you're giving those away as a good thing. Grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. So what must I do to inherit eternal life? This is a question that we seem to always be asking ourselves and seems to have been a question for as long as we have written history. What must we do to have, or what must we have, or what do we have to do in order to get to heaven? In our gospel for today, the rich man asks Jesus this same question and gets an answer he really is not wanting to hear. When the rich man asks Jesus how to inherit eternal life, Jesus has him remember the Ten Commandments. The rich man responded by saying that throughout his entire life, he had never murdered. He had never committed adultery. He had never stolen anything. He never bared false witness against anyone, and he had never defrauded anyone. And he had always honored his mother and his father. He had thought that this had to be enough to gain eternal life. So, is this enough to gain eternal life? We often ask ourselves this question as we look at our own lives. And as we ask this question, we may then come to realize that we maybe have fallen short in one or more of the commandments. Maybe we have bared false witness. I haven't figured out what the past tense of that is, but bared false witness to somebody. Or maybe we thought we would love somebody dead, and thus we murdered them in our own mind. So, we then may think that maybe there's a way to make up for these shortcomings. We come up with different ways to make up for where we messed up, many of which end up being connected to our life here in church. Being that that is often the case, I found a scorecard that allows us to score ourselves in our faith life. And as you can see here on the screen, you're able to score yourselves between 1 and 5, with 5 being the highest score on each thing. So, in these 8 categories, I want you to score yourself. And then keep your scores in mind. I'll give you a little bit here. And we'll keep this up here for at least a little while. Since the man scored himself high when it came to the commandments, it's likely he also would have scored high on something similar to this scorecard. But Jesus still said he was missing one thing. So Jesus told him, "Go sell what you own and give the money to the poor. Then come, follow me." But why? The man was stuck. How could he give up everything he owned and give up the life that he knew? Doing so meant giving up everything he held dear. But the thing is that Jesus is not actually asking the rich man to sell everything and give the money away just because Jesus wants the man to be poor. Jesus is saying that the rich man will learn something by selling everything and giving all the money away. What the man will learn is simple. By becoming poor, the man will realize that money is not the center of his life. He will stop holding earthly things above godly things and above God. And he will realize that God should be the center of his life. By doing this, and then by following Jesus, he'll be able to learn more about his life and his relationship with God. So when we look at our lives, what is it that we hold above God? Is it money or things like the rich man? Is it sports or music? Is it celebrities or comfort? Is it our country or our political party? Is it something else or a combination of a bunch of these things? When we hold things above God, Jesus tells us to give up those things and then follow him. It doesn't matter how many good things we do in our lives, if we are holding things above God, the great things that we do don't matter. When we hold stuff in our lives above God, we in fact break the first commandment. The first commandment reads, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. So what does this mean? According to Martin Luther, this in the Small Catechism, the commandment means that we should fear, love, and trust God above all things. But when I was in confirmation and Sunday school and going to children's sermons and whatnot, I was taught that this commandment means that we can't make people, whether real or fictional, as people we look to any more than God. I was also taught that making idols meant deciding to play games or watch sports or do other activities instead of going to church. What I wasn't taught is that the lesson that the rich man was taught in our gospel today. I wasn't taught that money could be something that we held above God. But that's something that our society frequently makes as an idol above God. Just as Jesus told the rich man, we too are called to give up the things that we make as idols, whether that be money or sports or comfort or politics or a president or whoever, or your country or anything. We have to give up these things that we make as idols above God so that we can put God first in our lives and that we can follow Jesus. So in our gospel today, Jesus goes on to say that entering the kingdom of God for those who have wealth will be like trying to get a camel through the eye of a needle. I don't know if you've seen any of those two things ever in your life, but they are drastically different sizes. A camel is I'm not 100% sure, it might be able to fit down the center aisle here, and a needle you can lose and stab yourself in the foot pretty easily. He isn't saying this because wealth or money in itself brings us away from God. It's the love and the idolization of money that brings us away from God. I don't know if I'm breaking any news to you, but when we die, we can't bring anything with us. You can't bring your things with you. So when we hold God above all things, we realize that death means resurrection through Jesus, which means that our death means that we get to go to what is most important to us. We get to go to God that we hold above all things, even if we don't get to bring our things with us. So, you might have noticed, and I heard some people asking, and maybe even been a little bit distracted by this ladder that I have up here that I have yet to address. So usually, when we use a ladder, we have it set up nice and sturdy, so that we can climb up to get higher, maybe to a light or whatever else. And when we try to inherit eternal life by the deeds in our lives, we're trying to climb an extremely tall ladder, with each good deed being one rung up the ladder. So every time we go to worship, we climb a rung. Every time that we help the poor, we go a little bit higher. Every time that we know something in the Bible, especially if somebody else does not, we get to go another one higher. But the thing is, we can try to climb this ladder as high as we can by our good deeds, but no matter what, we'll never reach the top of the ladder. We'll never reach eternal life. This 6-foot ladder is nothing compared to the ladder that we have to climb to reach eternal life. The ladder is too tall. And even if we were to reach the top, there would still be a gigantic gap, probably about the same size as the ladder, that we still need to climb without a ladder. So, the ladder might be too tall for us, but this isn't the case for God. So instead of making us climb up the ladder, God turns the ladder upside down. God comes down the ladder and helps us. God comes down the ladder and teaches us. God comes down the ladder and saves us. So God comes down the ladder through Jesus. And by Jesus' death on the cross, we have been saved. Through Jesus' death on the cross, we have been saved by grace. By Jesus' death and resurrection, we no longer need to climb the ladder. God comes down the ladder for us. If the score we get on this scorecard told us what we were that we were going to get to eternal life or not, I'll tell you, the score, the grading system is out of 100, and you can only get 40 points. So you're not going to get there based on this. If we want to get saved by our behavior, the bar is extremely high, so that even the tallest ladder could never reach it. So high that the score that we need on our scorecard is completely out of reach. There's only one that has perfectly passed the test and not needed any help gaining eternal life. And it's not likely that any of us here or any on earth are ever going to be the second. And it's not likely that anyone else is even going to come close. This is where grace comes in. Grace is what God gives us that turns the ladder upside down. Grace is what God gives us to allow our scorecard to break the scale. It's the bonus points on your test. Grace is what God gives us even when we don't deserve it. It is only by the grace of God that we are saved. So then, what do we need to do to get that grace? What must we do to inherit eternal life? The answer is nothing. We can't earn grace. No matter what we do, no amount of good works will get us any more grace. Grace is a gift. Grace is a gift from God, freely given without any stipulations. So the reason that we do good works is to celebrate the grace that God has given us. So if we want salvation, if we're going to inherit eternal life, it will come from God. Because as Jesus taught us, for mortals, being saved is impossible. But not for God. For God, all things are possible. And for that I say, thanks be to God. And amen. Our hymn of the day today is, I think, Will You Come and Follow Me? Yep, number 798.
Call your name. Will you care for cruel and kind and shape the world around. Through my sight and touch and sound in you and you in me. Lord, your song is echoes true with you, but call my name. Will you turn and follow you and never be the same? In your company I'll go, where your love and footsteps show. Thus I'll move and live and grow in you and you in me.
Let us confess our faith using the words of the United Church of Canada Creed. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Uniting God, you call forth different gifts in those who follow you. Encourage us to welcome the diverse benefits and blessings of the whole church in teaching, preaching, prophecy, healing, and more. Lord, in your mercy. Nurturing God, you bring forth crops from the soil and bounty from the trees. Increase the produce of the land and bless all who toil in fields and orchards. Provide for good working conditions and keep them safe. Lord, in your mercy. Empowering God, you offer compassion for those who are overlooked or forgotten. Open the hearts of local, national, and world leaders to show such compassion and love for their neighbors. Lord, in your mercy. Sheltering God, in Jesus, you traveled among us without a place to lay your head. Provide safe places to sleep and rest for those who have no place to live. Sustain ministries that offer food, clothing, and peace of mind, especially those that are in our community. Lord, in your mercy. Renewing God, you bring life out of death. Help us part with those things that are no longer beneficial to us and open our hearts to see where new life is budding in this congregation. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal God, we thank you for the lives of those who have died. Make us confident in your promise of salvation and support us in our own journey of faith. Lord, in your mercy. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ, which surpasses all understanding, be with you always. Let us share a sign of that peace with one another safely. Peace. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened us to the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Through the grace of God, all are invited to the table. No matter who you are, no matter what you believe, or where you are in your faith journey, or what you've done, you are welcome here. We will distribute communion at the rail. Grabbing a cup from the center aisle as we come forward, as the ushers indicate. If you are in need of a gluten-free option, please indicate so to the communion servers. And if you're unable to come forward, please let the ushers know. The table is ready. All who hunger and thirst, come.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, sacred dwelling of the Most
This pausing is causing my heart to explode. Why, when I'm weary, so often you seem far away, still I will say, Abba, I belong to you, I belong to you. Abba, Father, Abba, I belong to you, I belong to you. Abba, Father God. What I feel is less real than all that you say. You told me you'd hold me through all of my days. So though my spirit is tossing and turning about, still there's no doubt. Abba, I belong to you, I belong to you.
Thank you.
taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I'll bless your name. You are my all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all.
And now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ bless you and keep you in his grace. Lord of life, in the gift of your body and blood, you turn the crumbs of our faith into a feast of salvation. Send us forth into the world with shouts of joy, bearing witness to the abundance of your love in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Receive this blessing. People of God, you are Christ's body, bringing new life to a suffering world. The Holy Trinity, one God, bless you now and forever. Amen. Our sending song today is Shout to the Lord, number 821.
We need some band. Come on, there comes one. Come on up and get your instruments.
Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength.
Go in peace. The living word dwells in you.